We will continue the question answer session. I have a question here. In the 12th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna talks about Bhakti Yoga, where he recommends that if one is not able to follow the regulative principles of Bhakti, one should work for Krishna. And then if one is not able to do that, one is not able to work for Krishna, then they have to give up the fruits of work. Are these different levels of development of bhakti? Yes, Krishna describes in the 12th chapter Bhakti Yoga practiced at different levels. The topmost level, then if one cannot perform bhakti or practice bhakti at that level, then the next level, next lower level, like that. So these are different levels that Krishna is talking about in the 12th chapter, 8th verse to the 12th verse. If there are different levels of progress in bhakti, is one superior to the other? No, it's not a question of whether something is superior or inferior. It is your ability to practice. Like somebody, let us say, goes to school and then learns basic mathematics, and then one goes on to the higher classes to learn higher mathematics. It's not a question of inferior or superior. But this seems contradictory, because the goal is to develop love and work for Krishna. So why is it said regulated bhakti is higher than working for Krishna? Regulated practice of bhakti is higher than working for Krishna. Let me explain this. The topmost level, Krishna explains in the 12th chapter, is to always think of Krishna and engage one's intelligence always in Krishna. In that way, one will remain or live in Krishna always, without a doubt. So that is the highest level of bhakti, where one becomes completely Krishna conscious. Now, if one cannot practice bhakti like that, then Krishna says, follow the regulated principles of bhakti yoga. What are the regulated principles of bhakti yoga? It is to chant Hare Krishna, to actually offer food to Krishna and accept prasadam, to sing bhajans about Krishna, kirtans, to study Bhagavad Gita or hear Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, all the different practices of bhakti yoga as we do in ISKCON or Krishna Consciousness Movement. If somebody is not able to practice those regulations of bhakti yoga, then Krishna says, work for me. Here, working for me is explained specifically. What does it mean? Everyone who is a devotee is working for Krishna. But here, specifically, working for Krishna means sympathizing with the Krishna Consciousness Movement. Specifically, that is explained by Prabhupada in the purport. That means somebody is not able to practice regulative principles of bhakti yoga, then they can help in propagation of Krishna consciousness by doing some voluntary service in the Krishna consciousness movement, or help in some way to propagate this Krishna consciousness. So here, working for Krishna does not mean that higher level of regulated principles of bhakti yoga means you stop working. No. All the devotees work for Krishna. But what kind of work they do, that is being differentiated in different levels. Next question. Can you please explain how a devotee gets freed from laws of karma and a non-devotee gets results based on laws of karma? Yes, this is a fact. A devotee who's practicing bhakti yoga directly is under Krishna and is therefore not subject to the laws of karma. Whereas somebody who is not a devotee is not directly under Krishna, but is indirectly under Krishna through Krishna's laws of karma. So the laws of karma are actually enforced by material nature under Durga Devi. So therefore, what is the difference? When somebody is under Krishna by doing devotional service, then such a person is actually awarded by Krishna everything favorable for progressing in bhakti. Whereas somebody is not doing devotional service, then according to the stringent laws of karma, according to whatever work they do, they get the results. In any case, whether they follow the scriptures or don't follow the scriptures, whether they abide by the laws of karma or don't follow the laws of karma, violate the laws of karma, in any case, papa or punya, they're getting bound up. In devotional service, one is freed from the bondage. That's the biggest difference between a devotee's performing activities in this world and a non-devotee doing any activity. The next question. After getting free from the cycle of birth and death, does the soul still stay in the universe of Krishna, or soul ceases to exist? Soul never stops to exist. Soul is eternal. Soul means you or I or any person, any living being. All of us are eternal. So the soul never stops to exist. But the soul or you or I or any person, after liberation from cycle of birth and death, if they have practiced bhakti yoga, they can enter into Krishna's planet or into the spiritual planets. But if somebody has not practiced bhakti yoga, then even if they are free from the cycle of birth and death, they have to begin devotional service to gain entrance into the planet of Krishna or the spiritual planets in the spiritual world. If they don't take up bhakti, then there is a possibility that they will come back to this material world to take birth again in the cycle of birth and death. Next question. While doing meditation, one has to keep oneself free from feeling anything or from senses. How is that possible for a human being in this body? One will feel hot if it is hot. How can that be controlled? Yes, what is meant by doing meditation while not being disturbed by the onslaught of different climatic conditions or different demands of the senses or body, etc., is that there are different stages of progress in practice of meditation through the system of Ashtanga Yoga. There are 8 steps. So one of the early or the first 2 steps is called Yama and Niyama. Yama and Niyama are rules which are to be followed and prohibitions which are to be actually abstained from. Just like controlling eating, controlling sleeping, controlling work, controlling the mind, controlling the senses. So all these are meant for becoming free from all demands of the body and the external sense objects, etc. To be able to sit down for doing dhyana, for doing meditation. So this is not practical in this age. Formerly, those who were serious about practicing such yoga, Ashtanga Yoga, or meditation, silent meditation, they used to go to the forest or they used to go to a sacred place. In seclusion, they would actually live and simply depend upon some little fruits or roots or berries available. And they would cut down eating, cut down sleeping, cut down even drinking water, cut down even breathing air, step by step, step by step, step by step. So that was the kind of practice they would do when they would practice Ashtanga Yoga. That Ashtanga Yoga practice was most suited for Satya Yuga, the first of the cycle of four yugas on this earth planet. But now in Kali Yuga, it is not recommended to do Ashtanga Yoga. So we have to practice Krishna consciousness or chanting Hare Krishna, chanting hearing. This doesn't require that you have to go to a secluded place. This doesn't require that you have to give up eating. It's just that we should not eat something which is not prasadam. We have to take prasadam. That's the restriction as regards eating. Otherwise, there is no restriction like Ashtanga Yoga in practice of Bhakti Yoga. Next question. Rains are produced by sacrifice. That's what is told in the third chapter. What does this mean? This means unless people perform yajna or sacrifice, there will be no proper rainfall, as we can see it's happening, especially nowadays. Now, what is the sacrifice we should be doing? Sacrifice is described in the Bhagavad Gita as performing one's prescribed duties, which are described in the scriptures. Now, the prescribed duties also, as I've explained earlier, are mentioned in the Varnashrama Dharma system. This Varnashrama Dharma system also is not practical to follow in Kali Yuga. Therefore, in Kali Yuga, the only sacrifice that is recommended is Sankirtan Yajna, or the sacrifice of chanting Hare Krishna. So that is the sacrifice everyone has to do. Then there will be proper rainfall. Neither we will have excessive rain, ativrishti, or anavrishti, no rainfall. So neither of these, we will have proper rainfall so that we can properly produce crops and get our lakes and water bodies filled up and rivers fully flowing with water, etc. Next question. Like people offer bali as sacrifice, that means they sacrifice some animal, kill some animal and offer it as sacrifice in some type of yajna. So how can that killing a living organism make God happy when he teaches that all living beings are equal and killing other living beings is wrong? Now, you have to carefully understand what is the way a animal sacrifice is to be done that is recommended in the Vedas. The Vedic recommendation of sacrifice involves one type of sacrifice involves testing the chanting of the mantra of the priest who is going to do the sacrifice by killing an animal and reviving that animal by chanting suitable mantras. If the priest is properly practiced and properly able to chant the mantras with the proper potency, proper power, proper purity, then such chanting will be effective in performing the yajna or the homa or the sacrifice. So to test whether the priest is able to chant properly or not, an animal is killed and it is revived by chanting mantras. What if the priest is unable to revive the animal? So that's why in such a sacrifice where the mantra chanting is tested, there will always be a referee priest or an expert priest who is an established authority or expert in chanting all the mantras. So if the priest who is going to actually chant the mantras is unable to revive the animal, then the expert priest will anyway revive the animal. So it is not that animal is sacrificed and then they have a nice feast of some chicken soup. No, that is not the idea of killing an animal in sacrifice. So it is misunderstood. This animal sacrifice is totally misunderstood by people. So there is no killing that happens. Actually, the animal is revived. In some rare instances, the animal which is killed is immediately promoted in its next life to the human form of life. That is in very rare circumstances. If the chanting of the mantra is done by an expert qualified priest, then the animal is even promoted to a higher form of life. So the next question is, people say nothing bad can happen to a person with heart. I have many examples of those who were devotees of God and had been the kindest persons, yet they only saw sorrow in their lifetime. How do we understand this? What is it that people expect to get as the result of doing some devotional activity, as the result of becoming devotees of God or following some scriptural directions for practicing spiritual life? Common people who do not know what is the real goal of life, who do not know who we are, who do not know what is the ultimate purpose of life, they think that let me worship God or let me do some spiritual practice and then I will have no miseries, I'll have no sorrow, I'll have no difficulties, I can live happily, peacefully, enjoy life in a nice way, in a pious way. No, that is not the result of practicing spiritual life. That is never the result. That should never be the result of practicing spiritual life. Spiritual life is meant for preparing ourselves to go to the Krishna Loka, to go to the spiritual world. We don't belong here. We have come to a wrong place, a place filled with misery. So our only aim in this human form of life should be somehow to actually live a life where we are able to maintain our body with the minimum necessities without being too much disturbed by bodily demands like hunger and thirst, etc. And then most importantly, under all circumstances, practice spiritual life, especially in terms of chanting Hare Krishna. If we do this, we are simply preparing ourselves to go to the spiritual world. And when we come to the stage of perfection, even before leaving this body, even before death comes, of course, after death, devotees are going to Krishna's planet. But even before death comes, if one is able to nicely practice chanting Hare Krishna and become peaceful by dint of chanting Hare Krishna, then one is able to live in this world without any difficulty, living a life of devotional service. And even if there are disturbances, a devotee who is absorbed in chanting Hare Krishna by practice is not disturbed. So even living in this world will not be a difficult thing. But before we reach perfection of chanting Hare Krishna, we have to tolerate. Therefore, Krishna says, learn tolerance. Learn tolerance. So, the real purpose of practicing spiritual life is not that we can live and enjoy in this material world very nicely. No, that is never the purpose of spiritual life. The whole purpose of spiritual life is to develop detachment, is to get out, prepare to get away or get out of this miserable material world. Not that we will make this material world into a comfortable, happy place. No. Krishna says, this world is dukkhalayam ashashvatam. Everything here is temporary. Whatever nice arrangements you make materially, it is not going to remain permanently, that arrangement. It is going to be disturbed. It is going to be changing. Neither you can have any real happiness. You cannot have some momentary pleasures are there. In some way you can arrange for some momentary pleasures with lot of elaborate efforts, elaborate arrangements, difficult tasks to actually constantly supply all the demands of your senses and keep your mind engaged or busy with some enjoyment. All that is actually foolish. to do. So simply don't expect to live a life of material pleasures by doing some spiritual practice. Next question. Bhagavad Gita 14th chapter 27th verse says, constitutional position of ultimate happiness is impersonal Brahman. What does it mean? Impersonal Brahman is understood to be one of the three features of the absolute truth, three features of the Supreme Lord Krishna. Krishna has three features. One is called the impersonal Brahman, which is the spiritual effulgence coming out of Krishna's transcendental form or body, which is actually illuminating the entire existence, spiritual existence and material existence, which is the spiritual sky, the Brahma Jyoti or the Brahman effulgence or the impersonal Brahman. Then there is the second feature of the absolute truth or second feature of Krishna is the Paramatma feature, the form of Krishna who is entered into everybody's heart and is actually maintaining everyone, is taking care of their necessities in this body. Just like all our intelligence is coming from Krishna. Krishna is digesting the food in our stomach. Krishna is actually providing the prana, the life air, the vital energy which is circulating in this body like an electric current, and all your organs are working. That is Krishna's role as Paramatma. So that Paramatma is the second feature of Krishna. The third feature of Krishna is Krishna himself, the Supreme Person, the Supreme Personality of Godhead in the spiritual world, and he also incarnates in the material world. So these three features. So this impersonal Brahman is the one of the features of Krishna. This impersonal Brahman, one is able to attain that particular stage of attaining that platform of Brahman when one transcends the three gunas, when one rises above the three modes of material nature by performing pure devotional service. So Krishna says that Brahman platform is the platform for experiencing ultimate real spiritual happiness. You cannot experience spiritual happiness as long as you are on the material platform. As long as you are situated in sattva-guna or rajo-guna or tamo-guna, you cannot experience any spiritual happiness. You have to get out of these influence of these three gunas, rise above the influence of the three gunas. That is possible only by practicing devotional service and coming to the standard of pure devotional service. Pure devotional service is performing devotional service without any motivation, without any material motivation, without any material contamination. So that stage takes time, but it is possible by following the rules of Bhakti Yoga. One can gradually rise to that position of doing pure devotional service, and that pure devotional service is the platform of Brahman or the spiritual platform. That is the platform of experiencing real spiritual bliss. Next question. What is actual Kriya Yoga which Krishna taught to the world according to verse 29 of chapter 4? In verse 29 of chapter 4, there is no reference to any Kriya Yoga. But if you have heard about Kriya Yoga and you would like to know what it is, Kriya Yoga is mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Kriya Yoga is nothing but devotional service. Activities performed which are in relationship with the Supreme Lord Krishna. There is nothing but devotional service. So Kriya Yoga is nothing but devotional service. The next question. Can you please enlighten the efficacy of reading different versions of Bhagavad Gita available in market? Now, Bhagavad Gita, as I have explained earlier once, is not something that different people can give different commentaries or different opinions or different viewpoints according to their understanding or according to their intelligence or according to their experience. No. Bhagavad Gita is to be understood exactly as it is explained by Krishna to Arjuna or Krishna to Brahma, and that knowledge is handed down by those who heard from Krishna to their next generation of disciples as it is, without any change, the way Krishna has actually explained to Arjuna, the same way we should understand. It is not just the words alone. Of course, the words should not be changed, but we should also understand the meaning of the word in which context Krishna is explaining something. Just like the word karma, if you read the Bhagavad Gita, many places the word karma is used by Krishna. Now, in each instance, what is the specific meaning of karma that should be understood? Karma has got many meanings. So, which meaning of karma should be taken in a particular usage? That you have to hear from somebody who knows and who has understood in the parampara system, in the disciplic succession. So, without referring to the Bhagavad Gita as it is received and understood and explained in the parampara system, simply reading some version or different versions of Bhagavad Gita is not going to help one understand Bhagavad Gita. Next question. In some place, Palghar, two saintly persons were beaten to death. Why such a bad destiny for a saintly person? Why such repeated misery for a pure soul who is a saint and 70 years old? I don't know the exact incident which is being referred to by the person asking this question. But in general, we may understand, if somebody is, again coming to the same point, practicing spiritual life, in what way does the Supreme Lord protect His devotees in this world, in this material world? Krishna's protection is always for protecting our practice of devotional service. Krishna protects us so that we may practice devotional service nicely, to perfect our devotional service, to prepare ourselves to go back to Him, to His own personal planet. So Krishna consciousness is not meant for preventing somebody from harming me, preventing some calamity from happening. No, that is not the purpose of practicing Krishna consciousness. So I don't know the specific instance that is being referred to here, but if somebody was practicing some spiritual life and they had to undergo some very bad treatment from some miscreants, then it is expected that they will seek shelter or relief from the police authorities, or they will take help of other people who can give them some protection or prevent the miscreants, etc. It is not that I sit and I do some bhajan and somebody comes and beats me and say, Krishna, you have to protect me. No. You have to seek protection from the proper arrangement or the proper authorities or the proper system. That is expected. And if the person is not really a devotee, then the person is actually simply undergoing the reactions of one's own past karma. If one's past karma is that one has to suffer by being beaten by somebody else, then that is simply the reaction they are getting for their past sinful activities. So unless one is really properly practicing devotional service, one cannot expect direct protection of Krishna. And even the direct protection of Krishna, it depends on Krishna, how Krishna is going to actually deal with the different situations which the devotee has to face. In any case, whatever happens, just like Prahlad, the best example we can think of in this connection is, Prahlad was actually practicing chanting the holy name of the Supreme Lord, Narayana. But his father was an enemy of Vishnu or Narayana, so his father was telling, don't chant. So, but still, Prahlad would not give up. He was a very staunch devotee. So his father became angry and tried to stop him in so many ways. Finally, the father decided to kill this boy, his own son, 5-year-old son. But how much ever the father tried to trouble the boy was not giving up chanting. Finally, when the father decided to kill, then the Lord appeared and killed that demoniac father of Prahlad. But even when Prahlad was actually being tortured in other ways, he was just continuing to chant and the Lord was mystically protecting him. Just like Draupadi. Draupadi had in one assembly where she was trying to be insulted by the Kauravas, she was appealing to all the Pandavas and all the elderly people, all the saintly people who were there. But nobody ultimately was able to protect her. Then she finally prayed to Krishna, and she was seeing that when she was holding on to her sari and thinking that Krishna will give her the strength so that she cannot be disrobed, she cannot be insulted, she saw that, oh, Krishna is not stopping these people from pulling my sari and disrobing me. Then she just threw up her hands and said, Govinda, please protect me. And then Krishna did something very, very mystical. Krishna did not stop that Dushyasana from pulling her sari. He simply supplied unlimited length of cloth. You see, who can expect this? Who can calculate this? Who can make some sort of expectations? Have some expectation? Oh, Krishna will stop. Krishna will do this. Krishna will do that. No. When you surrender to Krishna, you leave it to Krishna. How Krishna is going to protect you? You are completely dependent, and you are not going to make any demand. How Krishna should protect you? That is very important. Of course, as a devotee, one should have faith that Krishna will protect me under all circumstances. But how Krishna is going to protect, we do not know. Neither we should be anxious that Krishna has to protect me in the way I want his protection. No, we should never make any calculations. We never make any demand from Krishna. That is the proper way of actually depending on Krishna's protection. What is the difference between, next question, what is the difference between prescribed duties and devotional service? By doing prescribed duties, Vishnu is satisfied. Does that mean prescribed duties are also devotional service? Now, prescribed duties is to be performed as described in the third chapter for those who are beginning practice spiritual life and are unable to directly practice devotional service. Then prescribed duties are mentioned in the scriptures, and by doing the prescribed duties, one has to sacrifice the results to the Supreme Lord in order to actually make progress in spiritual life. And gradually, by performing prescribed duties as sacrifice to Vishnu, one can actually come to the platform of beginning devotional service, accepting devotional service practice. Next question. What is meant by religion? In 18th chapter, Krishna says, abandon all types of religion and surrender unto him. So what type of religion is to be abandoned? Yes, it is explained When Krishna says abandon all varieties of religion, it means that whatever religious principles we were following before surrendering to Krishna, after surrender, if we see that those religious principles are coming in the way of our surrender to that particular situation, Krishna says, you can abandon those religious principles which are coming in the way of your surrender. You surrender unconditionally. If some religious principle is coming in the way of your surrender, you give up that religious principle. Then what happens if I give up my religious principle and because of that I incur sinful reaction? Krishna says, don't worry, I will free you from any sinful reactions that may be resulting from your giving up some religious principles. So that is what Krishna means by abandon all varieties of religion. So surrender is unconditional surrender. It is not conditional surrender. Next question. What chapters of Bhagavad Gita come under category of Jnana Yoga? We find chapters on Karma Yoga, Ashtanga Yoga, Bhakti Yoga and Bhagavad Gita, but not about Jnana Yoga. Jnana Yoga is explained in the fourth chapter. It is the title given in Srila Prabhupada's book is Transcendental Knowledge, but it is nothing but Jnana Yoga. So the fourth chapter is the chapter on Jnana Yoga. There Krishna explains how all sacrifices lead to enlightenment in transcendental knowledge. And that transcendental knowledge is knowledge about Krishna. That Krishna is the Supreme Lord and every living being is part of Krishna, belongs to Krishna and is always situated in Krishna. Three facts Krishna says about transcendental knowledge in that chapter, fourth chapter, 35th verse. He says, when one is fully enlightened in transcendental knowledge, one will realize that every living being, without exception, is part of Krishna, belongs to Krishna, and actually is in Krishna, situated in Krishna. So, this understanding leads to a particular a state of existence where we come out of the misunderstanding, I am this body or some other person is that particular body. We come out of the misconception of identifying with our body, mind, intelligence, ahankara, false ego. All this we come out by transcendental knowledge, by enlightenment in transcendental knowledge. And then when we are perfectly understanding, I am spirit soul, everyone is spirit soul, but all of us are part of the same Supreme Lord. We all belong to the Lord. Then there is no more any separate understanding, separatist vision. There is no more any prejudice. There is no more any misunderstanding. There is no more any misconception about oneself or others or this world or about God himself. See, we don't see anybody as separate from, as disconnected from God, as independent of God. Everyone belongs to God. Everyone belongs to Krishna. Everyone is part of Krishna. Everyone, Krishna claims everyone is mine. So everyone is actually Krishna's own part. So nobody is that sense apart from or independent of Krishna. That understanding is the result of transcendental enlightenment. I'll stop here. We will take some more questions tomorrow.